ganks and avoid fights for the most part.
It's good counter-initiating against Clockwork, too. You just throw your cask and then just dump down your ward, and it's really difficult to stop the ward if Clockwork has to hookshot in, and you don't really want to hookshot in on the Witch Doctor.
All right, well, things have unraveled here. Without Game 1 draft, Alliance taking on Team Secret. Opening game in the Red Bull Battlegrounds Dota 2 Europe group play. We're going to see Team Alliance on the Radiant side. It's going to be Mad playing the support Bane. We're going to have Niqua playing the Spirit Breaker. We've got Pycat playing the Troll Warlord. Loda on the Juggernaut. And that leaves Ake playing the Witch Doctor. They're going to be taking on Team Secret on the Dire side. It's going to be Zai on the offlane Clockwork. Boots first for him. S4 going to be going mid lane on the Shadow Fiend. Puppy on your support Lich. TZ going to be playing your Sniper. And then it leaves finally Kuroki playing the Night Stalker as that four position support currently up in the top lane. So seeing these two drafts, feel either team has a draft advantage coming out of this one, Ben?
I'd say Alliance is far easier to execute. And aside from that, I think both of them have their strengths and weaknesses, and overall they're about equal. There's not one that I like in particular. How about yourself?
I think if Secret execute their draft and manage to like avoid the early game aggression, they can just sit back and... I slightly favor Secret, I guess, but I'm not dead set on that. The Troll Warlord factor is definitely there.
I mean, Alliances has much better like later, I would say, just because they have so many things against BKB. Pretty much all their heroes can do a lot of work against BKB, whereas Secret, like Lich, Clock are both pretty useless against BKB. Night Stalker isn't terribly useful, and Sniper doesn't have any like bash, which Spirit Breaker and Troll Warlord do, so he's also going to lose to BKB War. So if it comes down to a passive farming game, I think Alliance will end up winning. So that's again why it's easier to execute for Alliance.
They're also going to get aggressive with their lanes as well. Offensive trailing at top, Ake is completely zoning Zai out of his safe lane. He can't even get to his tower until a creep wave comes along. And Bane's going to head back mid lane. Probably look to drop down some enfeebles on this Shadow Fiend. Alliance going for a very aggressive laning set with the offensive trailing, but Secret have kind of preemptively put their sniper in the bottom lane to make sure he can get some farm.
Yeah, I think it's a good idea for them to do the sniper dual lane off. Firstly, it's not that expected, and secondly, it's just really easy to protect them down there.
So it's just the Witch Doctor zone top lane. It seems like both teams turning their off lane into the safe lane at this point. Neither safe lane solo hero are going to be able to get too much. Niqua as well as Zai, thinking they maybe had an easy safe lane, but not quite the case.
Yes. If you pair up the Sniper versus the Spirit Breaker, the Spirit Breaker is not that big of a threat. What's he going to do? Charge you with no one else in the lane? It's only scary if Spirit Breaker comes from another lane. So ideally, our TZ should always be matched up versus Spirit Breaker.
All right. Well, similarly, it's top lane. There's not much the Clockwork can do up here. The Bane's coming back. Hasn't skilled anything just yet. Has gone for the boots first, so maybe hoping for a potential Nightmare initiation onto Zai, but for the time being, not finding too much. He's going to swing back towards mid lane. 2 minutes approaching, so these first couple of runes are going to be coming out, and I think Puppy a bit worried about this top rune being a death trap, as he's not even going to go.
He has scouted it, though.
Yeah. Knows it's a bounty rune, and it's a haste rune bottom lane. Kuro's going to look to rotate. They're going for a gank here. Pycat takes a raise. There's your Void Slow, but from behind comes Machka. He's going to have no spell leveled up just yet. One Frostblast comes out from Puppy, and neither team going to be picking up any early kills here.
And looking at the CS in the mid lane, Troll is winning big. 11-3 versus dual lane, and this is with a lot of creeps being sacrificed. So I'm very impressed with Pycat's CS in the mid lane.
Yeah, has the early bottle up, and 2 points in the Whirling Axe, standard stuff, but yeah, S4 has just not found the farm that you'd hope for with a dual lane Lich Shadow Fiend.
Yeah, they need this lane to win. Like, Lich's greatest strength, I'd say, is just straight up winning his lane and denying the opponents a lot of farm.
And looking at the two farmers, RTZ as well as Loda, pretty similar as far as the actual last hits go, 14-12. Fair few more denies on Loda, but he's actually sitting on 14 last hits, 14 denies. Last hitting machine up in this top lane, and Zai, as a result, just level 2.5. Similar story for your Spirit Breaker, though. He's just level 2.5, not really getting too much out of his lane against the opposing carry.
Yeah, and both heroes are probably equally useful or useless, however you want to look at it, without farm. So I don't think either team is getting too much of an edge in these side lanes. Zai is able to creep pull, though, so that's definitely working in his favor.
Yeah, he's going to be able to leak some XP here. Matt comes in, has a point of the Nightmare, gets pulled into a Cogs. No battery assault leveled up, but with the creeps here, some good damage coming out. And Mad going to lead with a Nightmare now. The cast coming from your Witch Doctor. Can Loader get here in time? He's going to be close. The body box is there. Zai gets out of there. No, he's getting blocked by his own creeps. They work against him. First Blood goes the way of Mad. The counter kill's now coming. Puppy gets one with the help of the Frost Blast. Knight's already getting the last hit. He's got a stick and another Void in just
Night
a second
time in
here.
3 seconds.
Uh-oh. The Healing Ward keeping Ake kind of healthy here. There's your slow from the Void, and it's not going to be enough from the Healing Ward. It looks like Ake with a cast trying to keep himself alive. The Healing Ward finally going to be brought down by Kuro. As nighttime hits, just 1 point in the Hunt of the Night, but here's your Bane. Back with a Nightmare, Loader. Not going to get the kill on Kuro, but the Bane will. He gets the Brain Sap off, and two kills apiece. A bit of a bloody mess here in the top lane. Alliance break even, but they got the first blood, and Bane, two kills to his name now.
And now Shadow Fiend has closed the gap in between the CS and the mid lane, just one CS apart from the Troll Warlord, who was dominating him so much early. And that gank on Zai just took forever.
Yeah.
Because they were stuck in the cogs, and then he ran away, and then he got slept. And they're going pretty much behind the T1 tower, and that just allows all the time in the world for Secret to come up, and also just biding time for that 4 minute mark, which is so crucial for Kuro to get his kills.
He almost,
boots NS.
Almost even managed to kind of get out of there as well. It was, if that creep wave didn't block him, I think there was maybe slight chance he could get away from Loader. Speaking of Loader getting constantly mana burned by the cogs, not really fun for him as far as having that kill potential now that he's lost that mana pool.
So they've scouted out the two heroes on the bottom lane with the Observer Ward that blocked the spawn, and looks like Arteezy is setting up for a kill. If Aki were out of position, they would certainly go on him, but Nico with 800 HP is...
Here we go, there's an Assassinate coming in. Okay, gonna go down. Nightstalker gets the kill, nicely played by Secret. Just a Shrapnel as well as an Assassinate. They're actually gonna go Nico with Charge on cooldown. They think they can get this kill. The second Shrapnel comes out, and Arteezy with the headshot slowed. They're gonna get another. Sniper gets one, Nightstalker gets the other. Nice aggression from Secret in the bottom lane.
Secret's just doing a very impressive job of protecting the Sniper. When you look at Sniper versus lineup, you view him as the weak point, the hero that you want to kill early, you want to kill often, and then it's going to be useless come 15-20 minutes into the game. But looking at him now, he's the highest CS in the game, he's been protected even though he's in the offlane, he has gotten a kill on the Spiritbreaker as well as another kill on the support, and he's also way over level. They were able to blow up that Witch Doctor because they had the Assassinate.
That's for getting charged at mid, but is invisible, so Nico not going to follow that one up.
Mad gets scouted out by Kuro.
Does go both ways here, but Kuro for now probably just wanting to heal up a bit with the Tranquil Boots, and Taz got backup on way. S4 has two raises available, and they're going to lead with a Void. One raise, one more raise coming out in a second with the Silence. Mad will not get a spell off.
The Night Stalker nighttime vision is underrated. I also don't know why Bane stood around. I'm not actually sure if they saw the Night Stalker.
I think he pinged it.
They pinged it, but I think they might have just like expected him to be there without actually seeing him. I think if you see him, you just immediately peace out.
Loader now getting spotted out, but it's going to be onto Kuro. They go in with the cars, looking to body block him with the illusions. Nice bit of play there. Kuro getting taken out. Loader gets the last hit. Good micro coming out from your jug.
A little bit of help from the ogres, too.
All right.
The cask bounce.
And Loader just going to rotate fully into the jungle at this point, giving the offlane to the Spirit Breaker. Probably going to make his way towards this bottom lane unless they decide they really want to give Mad the solo XP. It seems Loader actually is going to go just for a straight up full jungle at the moment.
So finally they've moved the Spirit Breaker out of the Sniper's lane. I think this should have happened a while ago. But now that Nico has died, it's a convenient opportunity for him to switch lanes.
Arteezy going for very early game items here. Phase, double Wraith Band. He offers a lot of damage output here in the early game.
You can't go greedy versus lineup. If you... Oh, Nico.
And he gets slowed down by the Void Silence up, but should have a charge out of this one. But Zai's there, ready, goes in with a Battery Assault. Can he get the charge cancelled? Yes, he can. Nico, I think, just charged Kuro, actually. Do you not charge down bottom, I guess?
It didn't look like it. I think it would have been stopped anyways, but maybe he could have timed it in between Battery Assaults.
If you get away, far enough away from the clockwork, I'm not sure how likely that would have been to cancel.
I see some stacks coming up. S4 taking on the Ogre and the Satyr stack, but no large camps stacked on the Dire side. Mad trying to catch up in experience after roaming for the fair amount of the early game.
decent as far as farm. Having boots as well as an urn on him. I'm looking at some of the supports. Kuro's got good farm. Tranquil's wand and almost an urn himself.
Oh no, they spotted out Arteezy's ward in the bottom lane, and the Alliance supports will ping it out and very likely deward it. And now they can't let a solo sniper farm their offlane, not versus their lineup. That's just unheard of.
I imagine Zai will give up this top lane at some point. He's level 6, approaching level 7, has his bottle TP coming out. This is kind of time for him to go gank with the hookshot, but if he's giving up to the sniper or the Nightstalker, we'll have to wait and see. It is daytime, so Nightstalker probably unlikely to want to go gank some of these other lanes just yet.
And Arteezy, being the efficiency king that he is, will start farming the Ancients. So that's kind of a nifty tool that you can use as the offlane sniper if you can't stay in lane.
It's not going to be fast by any means, but it beats farming nothing. I guess you could go back to your own jungle, but hey, why not? Take a little bit here and here and there, and yeah, he's going to get some at least okay farm there at your Ancients, and Secret making the most out of what they can get here. The mech coming soon on S4, and then probably around the next nighttime, I imagine they get aggressive using the SF mech, using the Clockwork Hookshot. Speaking of Clockwork Hookshot, he goes looking for the bottom lane, but Creepwave completely blocks the hook onto Aki, not even close to that one.
Yep, a lot of that is due to that very nicely placed Observer Ward by Alliance. They scouted out the ward, they scouted out the Clockwork Ink. It's paying dividends.
We'll see what Alliance's next move is going to be. Right now they have both Troll and Jug who kind of both want to take over some of the farm in that jungle, but Pycat getting enough out of the mid lane. 0-0-1, he's sitting on 57 CS, is being outfarmed by the Shadow Fiend by a pretty big margin at this point. But that's kind of the nature of the Shadow Fiend. You can rotate in the jungle, taking out the big camp stacks. He's getting a lot out of the lane as well as the jungle.
Alliance
right now
going in for a kill on Arteezy.
Not going to succeed. They do get the D-Ward off.
So much of Alliance's strength is being able to take out Roshan. And Secret, they have enough of a lead that they have good enough control of the pit. But if they give up one fight, especially during daytime, then they can easily just give up a Roche. And even if Secret know that they're in there, they might not be able to stop it. So they have to be really careful not to give up any unnecessary kills, and especially like big team fight wipes. Pycat and Juggernaut are still a little bit under farm right now, but they're going for a pick to take down some towers and then to take down Roche. Mad and Loda smoked up in mid behind the T1 waiting for someone to peek their head out. Mm-hmm. And it will be S4. He has a mech.
Treads. This is not going to be the easy of kills, but with an Omnisize, they think they can get it. Pops the mech now. S4 still tanking up, and this playthrough may not be enough. Just level 1 on an S4. Going to get around. The hookshot off the mark, though. Zai cogs in S4. Bit of a mishap there from your Clockwork, but it looks like they'll get the Sloan Loda anyways, and all these guys are healing one at this point. Chewing through the Omnisize Blade Fury, no cancel onto the TP on the Bane, so...
What a disaster.
Secret rotate in all 5. They could have got even more off of that, but they did not come close to killing... Oh, they came close, but...
This is why Sniper and SF are just going completely non-greedy builds. S4 just built pretty much all the defensive early items that you can, Magic Stick, Mech, and Treads on the Shadow Fiend, as well as the Bottle. So he is probably the only hero that can tank that amount of burst.
He's going to get charged at the mid lane. Netherstrike comes through as well. The silence on the Mad means no brain sap for now. Kars goes flying with a Death Ward. S4 getting low, gets another mech off, gets slowed up. But now the Urn comes in. He's being healed back up. Has a rune waiting for him at top lane. Make it a double rune if he wants it. DD and an illusion. Actually, Zai going to brief his bottle with that. No one going down just yet. And Alliance going to be forced back once more.
These are also with missed hookshots, mind you.
Yeah.
Zai hasn't really been doing that much in the way of hookshotting and initiating for them, but Secret is still coming out ahead. 7-3, the kill score.
He's got another hook available. Doesn't have the mana for the battery assault as well, but possibly a hook into a cogs. He throws out the rocket flare. There's your hookshot. Where's the follow-up, though? Assassinate, not going to be enough. Kuro wanted to go for that one, maybe thinking he should have cast the assassinate. Again, Zai not being the most impressive game from his Clockwork, but I guess he did zone him out so they can get the T1 tower.
Space greed.
Yeah. It's not the ideal result. Your Clockwork hooks in on a low HP Bane, you're thinking you have a kill, but...
Yeah, it's nighttime for Secret. It's time to take down objectives, take down those T1s, and protect the Roche Pit. The Roche Pit is just so important, and they're already... Alliance is already having a hard enough time face rushing the Shadow Fiend and the Sniper, and if they get an Aegis, they're just going to play so aggressively on them that their face rush strategy is going to completely fall apart.
Okay, well, we'll see how many objectives they can take during this time. Arteezy's back towards the offlane, just solo farming as an offlane sniper. He's
without wards.
Really good. Yeah, 2100 gold, Phase, double Wraith Band, nothing super impressive right now as far as items go, but the fact he's on par with the top farmers.
Oh, they smoke up top. Kuro's out in front.
Can they get him? The charge is going on to S4. Once again, they want to go on the Shadow Fiend. He picks up a TP. Kuro there gets a silence on Niqua. No Nether Strike for now. S4 pops a mech, but the Omni Slash will finish him off.
I don't actually know why Kuro waited to silence him. I think he could have interrupted the charge.
It doesn't interrupt charge, the silence.
Well, what about the Void?
Oh, the Void, yeah.
Yeah, he could have interrupted the charge and then...
I thought you meant the silence, yeah.
Well, he silenced the ultimate, but by that point, he was already in a terrible position. And if he had stopped the charge, they could have retreated back to the T1, yeah. And then Elias may have reconsidered engaging on him. However, he will take a spill, and Zaya, again, nowhere to be found. Where's those clutch hookshots? He was in a pretty good position. Like, if they hookshot and then he went a little bit to the northwest and then cogblocked them, and then they Requiem, they would have been able to take a fight there. But an unreturned kill.
Just need to tank some of the Omni Slash as well. That's just a level one Omni Slash from Lotus. So if he hooks in and helps SF out there, it could have been a very different fight. We'll see the move towards the mid lane now. S4, gonna start throwing up some raises. Pycat doesn't get hit by the hook. Again, Zai slightly off the mark. This has just not been his game on the clock. Secret's still looking okay here as far as the farm goes. Shadow Fiend topping the net worth chart. Snipers picked up a Blink Dagger as well. Not a very common item to see on snipers anymore.
Yeah, most certainly not. And we also see Kuro. He's getting Fiends gripped up top. TP reinforcements coming in. He is saving it for the Midas.
Fiend's grip is going to end, and the slow's not going to hit with a big nighttime. Tranquil Boots giving him so much movement speed. That's a hasted troll, but Kuro going to turn and fight now. The Void Slow is there. Chain Frost available. They may not even need it. Pycat going to go down to your Lich. Gets too aggressive up top, and Alliance feed away a bit of a freebie there to Team Secret.
I must say, like, Kuro is playing amazingly on this Nightstalker. He's a support Nightstalker, and he is really highly leveled. He almost has his Midas, and he's been putting Alliance in these really bad positions. He's like farming right outside of their T1 tower, and he's daring Alliance to go on him.
Kind of making up for, I guess, Zai's performance. He's actually out farming Zai on the clockwork, despite Zai having that safe lane just for quite some time. Kuro now going to help bring down this tower. This will be his Midas money, although he doesn't quite get the last hit. Goes away with S4 Shadow Fiend, and S4 now close to a Yule Scepter, just 200 gold short.
And notice every time it's nighttime, Secret go and push for an objective.
Aki at mid lane, could be in some trouble here. Arteezy thinking about chasing, but not going to fully commit to that one.
Another ward placed for Secret, a very aggressive one right above that T2 ramp in the mid lane. Alliance, they have two wards, but they're only covering the bottom. And that's only to protect Spiritbreaker's farm, which is not of utmost importance. But they do have Troll and Juggernaut. Both can take out Ancients, both have Lifesteal, both can also solo Roche.
Okay. S4, gonna finish up the jungle farm, get up his Yule Scepter, and Kuro, he wanted that farm, he wanted his Midas, but he's gonna take a separate camp here, so. Things looking very good for Secret, and kind of as you mentioned, Alliance's inability to take down Roshan is going to really hurt them moving forward here in the mid-game. Medallion up on your Lich is just going to make it so that it's much more likely Secret who take Roshan for themselves.
The items are coming out for Secret, but this is the point in the game I think where they're supposed to be slightly ahead given their lineup, with Nightstalker being, I'd say, more effective early before BKBs come out. Lich really effective in the early game because of Sacrifice, and I don't actually know if they have enough of a lead. It's only about 6,000 gold for them, but once BKBs come out for Alliance, or for Troll and Spiritbreaker in particular, it's going to be really rough for Secret to cope with that in team fights. However, they will have the Aegis to help them.
Blind Roshan. I guess Alliance have no good scouting tools, and just not. At this point, Alliance have much better vision on the map. There's no wards for Secret. This is some risky stuff.
It's because they took out those two towers. Yeah. Alliance don't have that much vision to work with because they're busy trying to spend time pushing out their lanes. And if they don't, it just makes it so obvious as to where they are and what they're doing.
Arteezy picks up the Aegis and makes his way back towards bottom lane. He's got Aquila, Blink Dagger, another 1,200 gold, and imagine he'll be starting to look towards a bigger damage output item at this point.
Alliance want to regain control. They have three Observer wards out on the map right now, but at the same time, they can't really take a fight. Not with that Aegis and not with all these defensive items on the Shadow Fiend. He has a Yule's on top of that. So screw getting defensive supports. He has all the items that they need because of a very successful early game.
Yeah, I feel, as much as Secret even meant to be ahead at this point, it feels like their lanes in early game went better than it possibly should have, with Alliance not really getting too much done with the offensive tri lane, the Bane rotation's not really amounting to too much.
Mm-hmm.
They really had to kind of overcommit to even kill Zai in that top lane. So we'll see what the next move is going to be. Alliance have got that kind of scary face rush mid game with the Jug,
yeah, but
now level 11 too.
That's one of their main facets of the strategy, as well as Roshan, and they've kind of failed at both, I would say, at least in the early game. So now that Roshan's gone a secret, now that Spiritbreaker has been very ineffective in the Pycat trying to TP out, he will get Chain Frosted and Assassinated. Easy kill.
Okay, well, Troll caught out in the top jungle, meaning Alliance give away even more. Nico even TP'd up there to try and help out, but it was well too late.
They're getting kited by all the slows, and this isn't supposed to happen, at least not what Alliance had planned into the game. So now they pretty much play defensive, farm up the jungle, farm up Ancients, get BKBs. Troll Warlord looks like he has an Ogre Club. I'm not sure if it's going to be S and Y or not, but Spiritbreaker certainly needs one. They just cannot walk in. Ake.
Not more freebies going the way of Team Secret. Kuro gets gripped up, but there's your hook shot. They're going to hit Mad with that one, and Ainsap maybe going to heal him up a little bit. Zai pushed out of his own cogs, and we'll find the kill regardless. It's Kuro getting that one. The Death Ward comes out. Netherstrike onto Kuro. They change target with the Death Ward. Kuro still alive and kick for now. We'll earn back up and turn and fight. They want Nichrome with the Frost Blast Rocket Flare. They'll get him. Jug goes down elsewhere. That's Arteezy getting a solo kill, it looks like. Oh, boy. Oh, blinks forward once more, once Ake. Assassinate is there, and with a Void, Ake goes down, Sniper. On a 4-0 dominating streak, 4-for-1 trade.
Everything's going wrong for Alliance. They have a Sniper who's blinking into them, who's solo killing their Sniper, who's blinking right under the T3 tower, and is just not scared of anything. It was just daytime, too.
Secret to playing this one very well.
Mm-hmm.
And right now, Alliance running out of options. They're just...
I think the two things have gone really well for Secret that maybe Alliance didn't expect. First is a Sniper offlane, and second is the roaming Night Stalker, who picked up a couple of early kills. And he like when Bane was sitting up that hill, he actually prevented with that kill on Bane, he prevented him from sending a vision. And once you don't have vision for that, you're really, really scared to go out for the next nighttime, the next darkness, and it's just a chain effect at that point. And now Alliance, I mean, they don't have wards in ideal positions. Before, it was predicting Spiritbreaker, but they want offensive wards. They have a face rush lineup. They want to go in and get kills. They want to be able to use battle trends on people. They want to charge in on people, use Nether Strike as well as Omni Slash, and they just aren't getting anything except for some farm on neutrals.
I do have an idea where S4 is here as he walked past a Radiant lane ward, but he'll make his way back towards his bottom lane. Getting scattered out once more. Charge coming out now. S4 in the side shop here, has a TP, not going to use it just yet, has the Yule Scepter as well to cancel the charge, and I imagine, yeah, Nico's going to have to cancel it.
That Observer Ward has died now, so Alliance's vision is just getting worse and worse as the game progresses.
Yeah. They got a new ward now down towards the mid lane river, but we'll see what they can get done out of that one. But the farm on Secret, on heroes that you wouldn't expect the farm on, Kuro almost has an Aghanim Scepter at this point. He's on 1,700 gold, just another 1,300 away from the completed axe. This is scary amounts of farm. They see Nikwa charging with a Rocket Flare. Zai's getting the hell out of there, and another unsuccessful charge from Nikwa, just going to cancel. It's still not necessarily a bad thing for him, as this is kind of just what you've got to do with the Spirit Breaker. Just throw charges around and hope you find one which is going to succeed.
Yeah, well, I think they're hoping a little bit too much at this point. Clockwork has been doing a good job of scouting out with flares and not dying. I mean, he hasn't hit that many hook shots except on a Bane who's channeling Fiend's Grip.
Hey, sometimes those are not the easiest. He had to sidestep around the Night Stalker even to hit that one. You know?
Sometimes creeps are
on the
way.
He hit a hook shot mid lane. Pycat locked in place, gets out of the cogs, looking to get past the next one, but his own creep's going to block him, and Pycat goes down. Kuro with another kill. Suddenly, just 500 gold away from an Axe Scepter.
That is a ridiculously farmed support. We call it support.
He's outbobbing the troll. He's almost caught up to the Jug.
Yeah, I mean, he has been just playing amazingly this game, phenomenally. And it's an unusual build with the Tranquil Boots and whatnot, but it allows them to just always stay on the other side of the map and always get vision. They don't really need Observer Wards because Kuro just constantly scouting them out and seeing where they're going, seeing where they're going to set up Spiritbreaker ganks. And I mean, if Spiritbreaker can't gank, he's not very useful. They can't really play the farming game with him.
Well, Secret now going to get to work on more towers here. The tier 2 at mid lane, unlikely to be standing for much longer. Arteezy almost has a complete Skadi. And going for just pure survivability on the cause of Secret. They say, we don't need to go for your Mask of Madness, your Yashas, your S4 on the Shadow Fiend. Doesn't want to go for a big, flashy damage output item. Everyone's just going defensive with their item builds. And
yeah, no Yashas even, which is a little bit surprising. No Maelstrom.
Well, Nikwa now, the charge going down towards bottom lane. He's going to spot up Puffy. There's your assassin. Arteezy realizes what's going on. Oh, he traps himself on the high ground. Nikwa gets himself a bit stuck, but it looks like Secret decide they may not want to take this fight regardless.
It's just a terrible positioning for them. They don't really want to fight outside of the creep wave.
Oh, Rocket Flare will scout Nikwa out on the higher ground. Zai could go for a hookshot, but he's Jug Illusions, causing him some problems, gets past him. There's a Frost Blast charge to the low ground. Nikwa goes in on Puppy. Assassinate is there. Now, Chain Frost going to go through, bounces back to Nikwa. Oh dear, and the hookshot's still available. Zai may look to go back in and hit Loader with this one, but on the sidelines, it's S4. Looking to bring down Pycat. Kuro again on the front lines. Loader gets an Omni Slash, but it doesn't bounce. It catches just one. The hookshot now there as well. Loader going to be on the run. Mask of Madness as well as Mantis Style gets him out of the silence. That's a Mask of Madness soon, but a couple of raises going to bring him down. That's a team wipe. S4 gets a triple kill, and Team Secret plow their way through Alliance to a 20-6 kill lead. And a very sizable gold lead on top of that.
Man, those illusions just own Nikwa.
Oh, man.
A bit of friendly Pulse fire there. Yeah. Doesn't happen too much in Dota.
Secret off of that. Get their sniper Skadi, the Night Stalker Aghanims.
And you can tell how pressured Alliance are, though, because they're taking fights like right next to the Roche pit without vision and during nighttime. And those are usually big no-nos, but they're desperate. They're taking fights that they normally wouldn't want to take just because they know they have to do something to try and get back in this game. But this game is all in Secret's control right now. Everyone's really farmed.
And even your support Lich is sitting on close to 5,000 net worth, is working on what looks to be a Crimson Guard, I guess, with this buckler. They've already got the mech on Shadow Fiend, unless they're thinking about swapping things over with that. But, well, for now, 15 seconds, a very fast Roshan respawn. Secret are going to be very pleased if they scout that one out fairly soon. And
I still think they want to take a fight around the T3s and then maybe siege high ground. I don't think they always want to play on their side of the map and keep farming up just because of one BKB coming out for Spiritbreaker pretty soon. I mean, they're farming amazingly well right now, and they're certainly outscaling just because of how much map control they have.
I think Loader just dodged a hookshot with Mantis Style. That was pretty sick.
Oh, nice.
It's not much like game-winning play, but it's something nice. It's something cool to see. Other problems for Alliance is they lost their gem. Matt actually bought a gem and lost it during that last fight. Goes over to Arteezy on the sniper, so I mean, you lose your Curie, you lose your gem. Everything just looking pretty poor for Team Alliance
at
this
point.
Yeah. They're smoking up. This is bit of a Hail Mary play, perhaps. I feel like they're just one team fight away from almost even tapping out, despite having Rax still standing. The comeback potential just isn't really there when you fall behind by this much against the lineup with Sniper as well as Shadow Fiend. And you've got such a vision disadvantage because of the Nightstalker.
They see Zion mid and they just completely ignore him. Completely skirting around, looking for an easy kill.
They get into Roshan at the right time. Seems that's what they have their eyes on. Where's that Rocket Flare? Hold on for 3 seconds.
He expects something. They know something's up. They've been missing for far too long, and they know that they're so far behind that they have to do something.
Oh, spots out Nikwa with the Rocket Flare, but not Roshan. They're going to be too late.
Yeah, where's the Rocket Flare? Oh, they expected it to come out a long time ago.
He shot it at the Spirit Breaker. The Spirit Breaker. They may fight this regardless. They may just say, who cares about Aegis? Let's go in. And that's exactly what Zai has in mind. Two hero cog. Aki gets silenced up. The Omni Slash is there. To the high ground goes Zai. Nice force up. Gets him out of there. Magicka on the Bane. Likely to drop to one more Rocket Flare. That's a 2 for Neil so far. Lich going to go down at the back lines to Loader. But the chase is on. Pycat getting slowed down by the Skadi. Nice Centaur stun coming into play. And Pycat still going to be brought down. That's not going to save him. 3-for-1 trade. Loader has the Aegis, but an easy team fight for Secret. Just as soon as they know where Alliance are, they're like, oh, Alliance are 5 men in the Roshan pit? Let's go take a fight. We don't care about the Sages.
Well, they all had to run away. They had good vision around there, too. Nice hook shot.
They have good vision around everywhere at this point, Ben, with a nice...
True that.
From behind comes Loader with a DD, but still not an easy fight for him to take. Gonna just go in on Arteezy. Mask of Madness and look to bring him down. Loader gets slowed down. Nice defensive cogs. Arteezy still being chased, and Nikwa gets hit by a hookshot. Battery Assault there as well, and with the Silence coming into play, he can't get off the Nether Strike. That's one more kill. Arteezy blinks forward, looking for Mad on the Bane, and bring him down with the clock once more. Aki next in line. Four dead on the sidelines. Alliance getting overrun. Their base now under siege. Tier 3 tower going down fast as the Rax next in line for Team Alliance to lose here at the mid lane.
Secret getting their revenge after Alliance.
Well,
recently 2-0 them.
That's easy, just saying, let's go for the tier 4s, let's go for the throne. What are they going to do at this point? There's three dead. Loader may have an Aegis, but...
He's like, Omni Slash me, bro.
Yeah,
look at him. He's ridiculous.
Isamer is just so useful here as well.
Yeah, it doesn't look that useful, because mitigation is hard to see unless it's like GA or something like that. But, I mean, that armor, 9 armor. It's rough.
Not to mention just the attack and movement speed slow when Loader's trying to kill heroes outside of the Omni Slash.
I don't think Alliance varied the damage type enough. I think going for the Jug pick was a little bit over the top. It worked well with their strategy, but at the same time, they didn't have any outs. Like, they already had a good Roshan taker. They already had good physical damage, and they already have good, like, anti-BKB and, like, Bash. So I don't really think they needed to go for the Juggernaut. And he was the one that ended up having, you know, a decent amount of farm in the top lane, but he just couldn't translate it to anything because him and him and Troll overlap in a lot of what they do.
All right, well, we'll see bottom lane now. Mad pulled out by Kuro. Where's the TP cancel? Yules is there. This time misses another hook, but this one not going to amount to too much. Easy kill on your Bane, who was just trying to get down some deep wards. Does get the ward above the Roshan pit. Meanwhile, Zai would have loved to have a hookshot for that one, but was still on cooldown.
Here's an axe.
Yeah, at this point,
you can throw
everyone's
up more.
Fine. Yeah. you can miss more and maybe hit a few more as well at the same time. Everyone on this dire side just getting scarier and scarier.
The systematic push.
Yep. They've almost got a Crimson Guard as well on Puppy. The dreaded Vanguard Lich coming soon.
Loda.
Can they bring him down? The charge is being used
on
Kuro.
He has ages. It's not worth it for them. Not when all five of them aren't there.
They want to kill Kuro. He's got a gem, but nice Yule Scepter coming out from your Shadow Fiend will prevent the charge, and Loda going to give up the chase. It's bottom lane, or where'd Sniper get that kill? Top lane, where they kill off the Troll.
That's another thing about the Night Stalker with the gem. Spearbreaker can't ever catch you by surprise.
And they keep sniping Curious. Second Courier kill in a row. Team Secret just finding more and more money to throw their way as Kuro gets up to 4k gold now. Could see like a BKB or something come from him, although not necessarily a BKB game against all this physical damage. Zai gripped up at bottom. Here comes his teammates, though. They're going to be able to protect him soon. He just needs to get out and stay alive. Netherstrike is there. Zai gets the Yule Scepter coming from the Shadow Fiend. Requiem to follow. Four stuff out. Zai still alive for now. The cast. Death's Ward. Zai, is he going to see kept alive? Almost with the hookshot. Four dead, though. Loader, the only one left standing. Alliance in all sorts of trouble.
This has to be GG soon.
Yeah.
They are just masochist if they stay in this game.
There's nothing to be gained here. The Shadow Fiend, the Sniper, both so tanky. Both going for the Skadi build.
Four heroes committing on a Clockwork. Couldn't even get the kill on
they
that.
They almost...
Or barely got the
yeah,
kill.
Yeah, barely got the kill. When he hookshotted there and cancelled the Death Ward, I actually thought it was going to live for a second, but... Team Alliance get